Okay, so hello everyone. Welcome to AVLSI lecture number 27, part 2, part B. So last time we have covered about the qualitative analysis of a differential amplifier. That is, we have put some numbers and we have studied how will the input-output characteristics of a differential amplifier or a basic differential pair will look like. Okay, and we arrived at the conclusion that whenever the difference between the inputs Vin1 and Vin2 is very, very small, at that particular point of time, my differential amplifier will act as a linear amplifier. Okay, and it will produce the output without any, you know, problem at all, without any distortion. But as the difference between the input Vin1 minus Vin2 increases, it becomes a non-linear amplifier. So what will happen? You know, one transistor will be on, other will be off, and it will carry all the current. So yeah, so that is what we have discussed. And also this differential amplifier is very, very sensitive. It can amplify even a smallest difference between Vin1 and Vin2. Okay, and its linear range only disadvantages. Its linear range is limited. That means there couldn't be so much difference. If there is too much difference between Vin1 and Vin2, it won't act properly as a differential amplifier. Yeah, so let's begin with today's topic. Last time we have discussed about the differential behavior. Today we will start with the common mode behavior of a differential amplifier. That is, we will study the effect of common mode signal being applied to the differential amplifier. And also one more thing, that instead of using a current source, we are going to use a MOSFET as a current source. Okay, so here you see M3 is the NMOS transistor, which is biased in the saturation region, which is acting as a current source. VB is the biasing voltage to make sure that M3 operates in the saturation region. So this is our basic differential pair with a realistic current source. Now, here in this case, here this differential pair will be sensing an input common mode change. So what do you mean by common mode signal? A common mode signal is the one whose amplitude as well as phase difference will be same. So that means it is as good as applying the same signal to the both the terminals, gate terminals of M1 and M2. Over here, we can see it carefully. Okay, so same signal Vin of CM, which is called as common mode input signal, is being applied to the gate terminal of both M1 and M2. Fine. So let's see, you know, what is the role of this ISS now? What is the role of this current source? M3 is acting as a current source, right? So its role is to suppress the effect of input common mode level variations on the operation of M1 and M2 and the output level. Basically, we saw in the last discussion that if we keep a current source over here, then the input common mode level won't affect the output or the operation of M1 and M2. So that's why we require a constant current source over here. And in this case, M3 is providing that feature. Okay, so what do we do next? We set Vin1 and Vin2 equal to Vin of CM, right? And then what do we do is we vary the Vin of CM, that is the common mode input signal, from 0 to VDD, and will analyze the behavior of the circuit. Okay, then the current source ISS is implemented by M3, that is NMOS transistor. Now let us proceed ahead. Now, since the circuit is symmetric to the left and to the right, correct, for M1 side and to the M2 side, what do you mean by symmetric? RD1 and RD2 are of same resistance, so we call it RD. Now, since the input is a common mode signal, what will be my Vout1? My Vout1 will be VDD minus ID1 RD. Okay, and Vout2 will be VDD minus ID2 RD. Now, since both the transistors are symmetric, basically, and also the Vin1 and Vin2 are exactly the same, the current flowing through both the transistors also will be same. So ID1 will also be equal to ID2. So in this case, if you see carefully, your Vout1 and Vout2 also will be similar, right? And we can write it in the form, we know that ID1 plus ID2 will be equal to IDSS, correct? So whenever ID1 and ID2 are equal, so ID1 will be equal to ID2, and that will be equal to IDSS by 2. Also, the VB is the bias voltage for M3. okay, for it to operate as a operate under saturation, for it to behave as a current source. Now, let us assume the behavior. What have we said before? We will vary the input common mode signal from 0 to VDD. So let's say in the first case that input common mode signal is 0. That means your gate terminals over here of M1 and M2 are 0. So that will turn off M1 and M2 transistor. So that means your ID3 is very, very small. Your current, since you are applying common mode signal as 0, your M1 and M2 transistors are almost off, right? Your ID3 will not be equal to your ID3, which is flowing through this empty transistor, will not be equal to 0 because you have applied VDD over here, right? So small current will be flowing over here. And what happens is your empty transistor won't be off completely. It will operate in the deep trap region. Okay, because we have still applied VB voltage and VP voltage is still not 0. Okay, so what will happen is, what will happen? Your VP voltage, that is your node P, the voltage at node P, this is same as your VDS3, will become very, very low. This will become very, very low, and that means my VDS3 has become a low value, correct? And when VDS3 becomes a low value, my M3 will enter into the deep triad region. And that is actually in the deep triad region, we know that your MOSFET will behave as your R-on resistance. So let me show it to you. Yeah, it's loading a little. So what will happen is this M3 transistor will behave as if it is a, it is operating in the deep triad region, and it is operating in the deep triad region. It is replaced by the on state resistance of the MOSFET, R on. And we know the R on formula is 1 upon mu n Cox W by L, VGS3 minus VTH3. Okay, so this R on 3 is controlled by VGS3, VTH3, W by L of that transistor, and mu n Cox. So that's what happens when M3 enters into the deep triad region. It is replaced by your on state, R on resistance, right? And but in this case, since M1 and M2 are off, your ID1 and ID2 are almost very, very close to 0. Okay, here I've written equal to 0, but it's almost very, very close to 0. And your circuit is incapable of signal amplification. So what will happen? Vout 1 and Vout 2 will be equal to VDD only, correct? Because ID are very, very small. So in this graph, this is my common mode input output characteristics. So if I plot a graph of Vin of CM, that is input common mode signal, versus the VP signal, okay, versus VP, node voltage VP, then we can see clearly whenever the input common mode signal is increased beyond VTH1, that is threshold voltage of one of the MOSFETs, then your M1 and M2 will turn on, and your VP voltage will also will rise along with it, because as your input common mode signal increases, your VP voltage also increases along with it. Fine. Now over here, if you see carefully, this is the plot of input common mode voltage versus the drain current ID1 and ID2. So as you can see, this is the normal characteristics over here for voltages of Vin of CM, that is the common mode voltages, lesser than VTH1, your current is 0. And after that, soon it reaches a value whenever the input common mode voltage reaches a value of VGS1 plus VGS3 minus VTH3, then the current starts flowing. Okay, and then almost the current will be constant. Now I will explain this point later, that how does this point over here marked in orange arrow over here, dotted line, how it has come to VGS1 plus VGS3 minus VTH3. How this point has come, we will explain it later. Okay, again, in the output, whenever we plot input common mode voltage versus Vout1 and Vout2, this also I'll come back to it later. Okay, don't worry about it. Now, let us proceed ahead. Now what happens next is, whenever the input common mode voltage is greater than the threshold voltage of M1 and M2, that is M1 and M2 are symmetric, right? So threshold voltage of both of them also will be same. So whenever common mode voltage is increased, beyond the VTH value, the M1 and M2 will turn on. So as soon as the M1 and M2 turns on, your ID1 and ID2 flows, right? And your VP also rises. So why does the VP rises, the node voltage VP rises? Why it rises? Because as your current starts flowing, your VGS also increases. Your VGS1 and VGS2 also increases. And what is VG1 and VG2 from here? VG1 is nothing but your input common mode voltage, Vin of CM. And VG2 is also same, right? And what is your VS2 and VS1 is VP. So when we say VGS is increasing, and whenever we say VGS is increasing, it means that VG minus VS is also increasing, correct? Therefore, we say that your VP also increases whenever your VGS increases. So in a sense, we can say that your node voltage VP is tracking my input common mode voltage. Okay. Now for the next case, whenever we have a high common mode value, common mode input value, that is Vin of CM is very high value. That means your VP is nothing but your VDS3. Okay, the drain to source voltage of the empty transistor. So whenever this VDS3 is greater than VGS3 minus VTS3, your M3 will enter the saturation region. Fine. So what was happening? Input common mode voltage was increasing. Along with it, the VGS voltage was increasing. Along with it, the VP voltage was increasing. Now the VP voltage is same as your VDS3. Now it has increased to such a high value that it is greater than VGS3 minus VTS3. Therefore, the empty transistor will enter the saturation. And now the ID1 and ID2 will remain constant. Now it will be constant. Okay. So now we can say that ID1 plus ID2 will be equal to IDSS, which is also equal to ID3. Fine. So now what do we do is, now we apply the KVL to the input loop. Can you trace down this blue color, part over here? This is the input loop. So what do we get? If we apply the KVL, we'll get Vin of CM minus VGS1 minus VDS3 is equal to 0. So what is Vin of CM? Vin of CM will be VGS1 plus VDS3. Now, for M2 to remain in saturation, VDS3 should be at least equal to VGS3 minus VTS3 for it to be at the edge of saturation, at least. So over here in the above equation, that is 27.2.1, instead of VDS3, we'll replace it by VGS3 minus VTS3. So therefore, we get this equation as Vin of CM is equal to VGS1 plus VGS3 minus VTH3. And for proper operation, that is M3 to be in the sure shot to be in the saturation region, we have to keep Vin of CM, that is the input common mode voltage, greater than or equal to VGS1 plus VGS3 minus VTH3. Now let me go back to the earlier input-output characteristics. So you understood where this is coming from. VGS1 plus VGS3 minus VTH3, it's coming from here, over here. Okay, equation number 27.2.2. Fine. So now if we see carefully, if my input common mode voltage is greater than this level, that means my M3 will act as a current source. Okay, so that's why we say over here, whenever the input common mode level is crossing a certain level, that is this this voltage level, that is VGS1 plus VGS3 minus VTS3, then ID1 and ID2 will remain constant. Then it will behave as a current source. And in the output characteristics also, initially your VOUT1 and VOUT2 is equal to VDD because ID1 and ID2 is zero. But as soon as your input crosses this, Vin of CM, that is input common mode level, crosses this level, VGS1 plus VGS3 minus VTS3, where M3 enters into saturation, that particular point of time, my VOUT1 and VOUT2 will also remain constant. And that constant will be VDD minus RD into IDSS by 2. Because now ID1 and ID2 is equal to IDSS by 2. Therefore, it will settle at this level. Okay, so clear about this characteristics, a common mode input output characteristics, very important one. Okay, we should know how does the common mode signal affect our differential amplifier or differential pair. Okay, so now let's move on ahead. Okay, so now in the last condition, let's say that your input common mode voltage is increased to a further level. increase to a very, very high level. Now what will happen is, now M1 and M2 will enter the triad region. Okay, and what is the condition for it to enter as a triad region? Your VDS will be lesser than VGS minus VTH. Okay, your VDS will be lesser than VGS minus VTH. So in this case, your VDS is nothing but your Vout is lesser than VGS minus VTH. Your VGS is nothing but your Vin of CM in this case, as your Vout 1 and Vout 2 are relatively constant. So over here we say that your Vin of CM is greater than your, let's just consider one side of it. Both the sides are symmetric, I know, but let's consider one side of it. So we can say from here, Vin of CM is greater than Vout 1 plus VTH. But what is your Vout 1? Your Vout 1 is nothing but VDD minus ID1 RD. And what is ID1? ID1 and ID2 is same as IDSS by 2. So we can say that Vout 1 will be VDD minus ISS into RD divided by 2. Okay, so your V in of CM is greater than VDD minus RD into ISS divided by 2 plus VTH from this. Okay, so this expression number 20, this equation 27.2.3 sets the upper limit on the input common mode level. Okay, your input common mode level, this is the upper limit of it. And this is the characteristics which we were talking about. The input common mode voltage versus the outputs, V out 1 and V out 2. So this VDD minus ID into R, the VDD minus RD into ISS divided by 2, it's coming from here. Fine, you all have any doubt over here? Anyone? Okay, fine. So yeah, you all have to go through this document a little carefully. So in summary, the allowable value of Vin is bounded as follows. So Vin should be greater than or equal to VGS1 plus VGS3 minus VTH3 over this limit. So only then your M3 transistor will enter into saturation and behave as a constant current source. And Vin of CM should be less than or equal to minimum of VDD and VDD minus RD into ISS divided by 2 plus VTH, which is given by this equation. Okay. Fine, it should be minimum. Why it should be minimum? Because unless it is minimum, then your what will happen is, then your M1 and M2 might enter into triad region, which we don't want at all. We want it to be relatively in the saturation region. So to avoid that, your input common mode level should be bounded within this limit. Okay. Now next is, actually we are plotting a differential gain of a differential amplifier as a function of input common mode level. Okay, so let's say whenever the input common mode level is lesser than VTH, then your gain is zero basically, right? As your gain increases, gain will increase as your input common mode level increases beyond VTH. So now as the tail current source, is ISS, okay, enters the saturation region. That is, M3 enters the saturation region, your gain will remain relatively constant. Why the gain will remain constant? Because your transistor M3 has entered saturation, so your ID1 and ID1 plus ID2 will be equal to IDSS. Therefore, the gain also will remain constant. Now, whenever your Vin of CM, that is the input common mode voltage, is very, very high, so now what will happen? Again, the M1 and M2 will enter into the triode region, correct? And when they enter into the triode region, let's say that Vin of CM is V2 value. So when they enter into triode region, again the gain falls. We know that GM in the triode region is lesser compared to the GM in the saturation region. So that's the reason why the gain falls over here for higher values of Vin of CM. So we have to keep we want the gain of a differential amplifier to be constant, correct? So we have to keep them within the limit of V1 and V2 for gain to be constant. See, this is not a frequency response. Okay, this is your differential voltage gain versus your input common mode level. Okay, so don't forget that. You have to keep within this bound. Okay, so this is the allowable value of V in of CM. So we cannot just apply any value of common mode level over here. It has to be bounded in this region, bounded by this limits. Okay, so now let's move on to the next topic. Next topic is about the output swings in a differential amplifier. We have seen this before. We can have an input common mode level and an output common mode level. Okay, so your V in 1 and V in 2 are your differential signal. See, in a differential amplifier in the input form, you can have both differential as well as your common mode signal. So such is the case over here. So let's say that input has a DC level, and that DC level is your V in of CM. That is the common mode level, right? And this had a differential signal, very small amplitude differential signal, V in 1 and V in 2. They are out of phase with each other, as you can see very, very clearly. And what do we assume over here is we need to find out how large can the output voltage swing in a differential amplifier. So what do? We let V in of CM be the input common mode level, and there is the output common mode level also. And we are assuming that the output common mode level is greater than your input common mode level. That is, the DC level of the output is greater than the DC level of the input. That is the assumption we make. Okay. And also we assume that the voltage gain is high. That means the input swing is much less as compared to the output swing. Here is the input swing amplitude and here is the output swing amplitude. It's an amplifier, right? So output swing will be much larger compared to the input. Now, what are we saying? We are saying that for M1 and M2 to be remaining in saturation, each output can go as high as VDD, but as low as V in of CM minus VTH. Okay, so what can I say? The output can go maxed value to VDD, but the lowest value it can go to V in of CM minus VTH value. As you can see over here, this is the input common mode level minus your VTH value. So it can go lowest to this value. It cannot go to zero. So your V max, V out max value will be VDD, and your V out minimum value will be V in of CM minus VTH. Now, the higher the input common mode level, the smaller is the allowable voltage swing. Okay, now you saw the significance of it, of input common mode level. If it is a higher value, then it will limit your output voltage swing. Now, but also your input common mode level, that is V in of CM, can be not be less than this number, this value over here. VGS 1 plus VTH 3 minus, VGS 1 plus VGS 3 minus VTH 3. Why it cannot be less than this value? Anyone can tell me? Why this it cannot be lesser than this value? Input common mode level. Why it cannot be lesser than VGS 1 plus VGS 3 minus VTH 3? What will happen if that happens? See, if your V in of CM is lesser than this value, it cannot be lesser than this value, because only when V in of CM is greater than this value, M3 will enter into saturation, not before that. Okay, so that's why. So now we are checking the single-ended peak-to-peak output swing. Single-ended means V out 1 with respect to ground, or V out 2 with respect to ground. This is single-ended output. So what is this now? VO max minus V in max. That is VDD minus V in of CM minus VTH. And what is V in of CM? V in of CM is nothing but VGS plus VGS3 minus VTH3. So we substitute the values over here and we get VDD minus VGS1 minus VTH and plus VGS3 minus VTH3. Okay, and we know that VGS1 minus VTH is nothing but my VDSAT. And also my VGS3 minus VTH3 is also my VDSAT, assuming that M1, M2 and M3 have same threshold voltage, correct? So now your output swing will be VDD minus twice VDSAT. Agree? So this is single-ended peak-to-peak output swing. What about the maximum output voltage swing for a differential amplifier? Now the maximum output voltage swing of the differential amplifier for a differential output will be twice this. Why? Because this is single ended. So if you take differential output, then it will be twice VDD minus four times VDSAT. Okay, so this is my maximum output voltage swing for a differential amplifier. Any doubts in this?